The first tool will be demonstrating the MAC spoofing because we already know the MAC can be spoofed because we have some of the attacks like man-in-the-middle attacks, like we already seen in the earlier sessions of the protocols. Like the protocols using the vulnerabilities or the kind of features, or due to the lack of the kind of security features in the protocol itself, we can exploit the vulnerabilities in the protocols. So one such mechanism is MAC spoofing, where this can also be used in the man-in-the-middle kind of things, because as we have seen, ARP doesn't have any kind of validation. So if, let's say, the attacker knows the MAC ID of the target, then the MAC ID can be spoofed and they can be used in the man-in-the-middle attack kind of scenarios. But we need to understand that mostly the man-in-the-middle attack or the MAC spoofing is only mostly works in the LAN environment as it is the layer two protocol. But even the operating systems also provide these kind of features because let's say there may be some scenarios, some positive scenarios, like let's say there is a license error associated with any one of the system. In any case, let's say there is an issue with the MAC, then we need to change the MAC address of the other system to the MAC address of the previous to bind that license. So there may be some positive scenarios also, but the same can also be misused where the MAC can be spoofed in such a way that this can be used for any kind of attacking purposes. So the tool we are trying to demonstrate here is called SMAC. But as this is the tool with the evaluation version, so currently, if any one of us will actually do a MAC spoofing, it will currently only change it to only one MAC. So before that, first we'll try to see the current MAC address of the interface. So we are just browsing it to command prompt, and we can type the command get MAC. When we actually use this get MAC, or else we can also type ipconfig slash all, which also give all the parameters of the interface. So similarly, if we type get MAC, this command will directly give the result of the physical address. So here we can observe that the physical address of my system is something like 0800A4 and C0. Then we'll try to use this the tool and try to change the MAC address. So whether the MAC address can be changed, so we'll try to observe. So for this, I think one thing we need to understand is most of the tools we need to run as the highest privilege or the administrative privilege, because what happens is it has to also tweak the settings in the systems, like even Nmap or Wireshark or whatever the tools we are actually using. So these tools will actually try to change the system settings. So mostly it will ask for the administrative privileges. So as this is the evaluation version, we don't have any license for it. This is only for the demonstration purpose. And we can observe here that the current MAC address, which we are trying to show is this one. Then we will try to change it to some kind of random IP. Okay, then we need to click on update map. Okay, but as you can see, as this is in the evaluation version, the current MAC, the spoof MAC address supported by is only 0C, 0C, and 0C1. Because if the tool is licensed, then we can actually change it to any of the MAC address we want. But currently, only one such sample is available in the evaluation mode. So now we can observe that the MAC address has been changed, and it will take some time to actually disable and enable that adapter also, because it needs to update the MAC address on that. To update the MAC address, we need to restart the system. And the other method, this is one of the methods. There is also the manual method that is already available in the system itself. Now, if you talk about the Microsoft system, like let's say, so now let's say this is the network adapter on which we are using. So just go to the properties here. Now for every adapter we have this option called configure here. So just click on the configure. Because most of the tools will also try to change the same behavior here. So if I click on advanced, you can observe one particular parameter called locally administered address. Now here you can see we can observe that the MAC address has been already changed, but to reflect it we need to restart the adapter once. So If apart from this, if you want to change again the MAC address, then we can direct, instead of using the tool, tool is one method, or else we can directly change the MAC address here itself. So this provision is already provided in the operating system itself, but this can also be used or misused to actually change the MAC address also. So this is one simple method to actually change or the MAC address with respect to the kind of thing. Okay. So this is about the tool of SMAC or the spoof MAC. The other tool we are trying to see is about the OS fingerprinting. As we have seen with respect to the NMAP, we can also use one particular tool called Win fingerprinting. This is available for Windows, and if a lot more can be also discussed during the day 4 and day 5 during the audit or the hardening parts also. So now let's say this is one particular tool. We need to provide the IP address of the particular system where we have different scan options also, like whether we want to scan the entire domain or Active Directory, and what kind of OS version we want, and what is the patch level of the system, what are the shares that are available on the system. So we can actually select the parameters or the features which we want, and we can also select the general options or the kind of adapters we want to change, and if also the port scanning can also be done with respect to that, the UDP scanning can also be done, so that what kind of services that are available on the system can be actually known. And even in the input options, instead of single IP, if we want to have a scan of the range or the kind of IP lists that are available in the network, that also can be selected in the input options. Now, once we select the kind of options we want, we can click on the option called scan. So now we can see in the lower part or then the output part, we can see we got the reply from the system, and what is the host name of the system, whether it the system belongs to a domain or it's a workgroup system, what is the SID, generally SIDs and the UIDs will be generally used for the user enumeration part in Windows, where the enumeration to understand the enumeration of the users also, these SIDs will be used. Or the, even though we see the user name, but the Windows operating system will actually bind it with the IDs only. So in that part, we can also have this features to understand the SIDs. And also we can see the password policy of the particular operating system. So what is the minimum password length, and what is the maximum password age that can be changed, and what is the password history length, and even attempts before lockout. So there are a lot of parameters that can be actually known. What is the date and time of the system, and what is the patch level of the system can also be known with this. And along with this, we can also understand what is the kind of shades that are enabled on this particular system. So maybe there may be some default shades, or unknowingly we may be enabling some shades and left it over. So those kind of shades can also be seen. And what are the services that are running on this particular system can also be known. Okay, so we can see there are a lot of services which are already running on this particular system. We can see some remote monitoring, or the remote desktop enabled, or some of the virtualization enables. So these are kind of things. And the next part is the users that are the kind of user accounts that are available in the system. So at a glance, we can observe all these kind of systems that are available in the operating system at a one go using this particular tool. So not only on the host machine, we can also scan the other Windows machines also if they are available in the network. So this is one kind of Windows enumeration, or the fingerprinting of the operating system that can be made or using this tool. So we have these kind of scanning. So often once we the information is gathered with respect to that system, so this kind of enumeration can be done on the system to understand what kind of services or what kind of ports that are available on the particular system. So there was a question also, like why actually we also need a port if we know the IP, then it is sufficient. So as we understood in the layered architecture, once we cross the layer 3, that is the networking mechanism, that is once we know the IP address, because IP address is only used for the routing part to connect or to send the packet on from one system to the other. But every system, as we discussed in the morning sessions also, every system also has this transport layer protocol. Because now let's say on my system, there may be some, we have already discussed, there are 65,536 ports are available. That means each port is a logical unit that is connected to a particular service. Now if we talk about port number 80, that is nothing but the service HTTP or the web service is associated with this particular port. If we talk about 443, there is HTTPS or the SSL kind of encryption over HTTP is used as a service. If we talk about port 53, again the port 53 belongs to the UDP and port 80 belongs to the TCP. So based on the transport layer protocol we use, like what kind of connection we are trying to, because the application owners will actually define whenever they are designing an application, whether what kind of transport layer protocol the application has to use. Now if we talk about the web, so this web connection has to be reliable. I mean, whatever the connection we have sent, the username or whatever the connectivity, it has to be reliable. So this uses the transport layer as TCP. Now there may be some kind of services like the DNS query, or some kind of services like DHCP. Then these services will actually use the UDP as a transport layer protocol, because we only try to query. And if there is no connection oriented also, then the application can handle this. So based on the type of feature the application uses, the transport layer is also very important, because that is where the TCP/IP layered architecture is maintained. So after, once we know the kind of IP address of the system, we need to also understand what are the kind of services that are available on the system. Because now let's say on the particular system, I am trying to open a browser, I am trying to open some 10 different websites. Now even my IP address is same, but how the system will actually try to understand, like the connections made to these 10 particular websites on a single system. That means there is some other parameter or the other layer protocol is also very important to make this connection possible. That is where these ports will also come into picture. We generally call it as a socket, the combination of IP address along with the port number. So whenever I am trying to, let's say I am trying to access google.com from this particular system. So whenever I try to open this google.com, my IP address will actually generate a random port and try to connect to the google.com on port number 80. Now this is maintained as one socket or one session. Now on the same browser, I am trying to open cdoc.in, let's say. Now at a time, the IP address will be common in this, but I need to differentiate the two kind of connections at a single point of time. So for this, I choose two different ports that combine to my system. Now these two sockets will be differentiated because even though IP address is common, the ports are different. So I can talk to two different websites or n number of applications, as many as ports are required. So accordingly, I can make these sockets and I can make the connections individual according to the kind of service I'm using. So this is where the ports are also very important in terms of communication. And based on the kind of ports we use, what is the transport layer protocol we want to use, whether it is the TCP where the connection oriented is possible with respect to the three-way handshake, or the UDP where there is no connection oriented, but simply we can use of the service or the ports only to connect between two services. So these kind of connections are possible. So if you want to know what are the kind of services or what kind of ports that are available, along with this, there is one simple command on the Windows or any Linux box. Just open command prompt and we can type netstat net stat space hyphen an. So this will give all the available ports on my system. Now we can see the protocol used, the local address or the system on which. Now you can see the combination of both the IP address as well as the port number. Now let's take example of 10.0.2.15:139. That means this is one socket where this denotes that on this particular IP, the service of 139 is binded, and you can see if there is any connection with the foreign address or the destination address, we can also see the kind of connection that is there. Like 10.0.15 with port number 50952, it is connected to one public IP address on port number 443. And we can also see the state of the TCP that is established. So this is how the communication, on a single system, I can make these many kind of connections possible by using both IP address as well as the port number. So this is where both IP as well as the services are also important. So once we understood the information gathering, we have gathered a lot of information, then we have done the scanning, we have found the kind of ports that are available on the system, and we have done some fingerprinting or the basic analysis of the operating system, then we need to know the kind of vulnerabilities that are associated, because let's say the ultimate goal of the hacking is to actually exploit and come into the destination and to take control of the system. So for this, we also need to understand what are the vulnerabilities that are associated with that particular system. So for this, there are a lot of vulnerability scanners available on the market, and there are different vendors who are providing this. One such is Nessus, and we have Nexpose. And also we have open source vulnerability scanners like OpenVAS. So there are different kind of vulnerability scanners that are available. So once we understand the kind of vulnerability, then we can make use of this vulnerability to actually use some of the exploitation codes to get into that particular system. So for this, we'll be trying to showcase one particular demo on the tool called Nessus. Currently we are using the trial version of this because it is also the commercial version. We have both commercial as well as the trial version. The trial version generally it is restricted to 16 IPs at a once. So, and also we need to get a trial license also. So if anyone wants to have a trial of it, they can simply log into nessus.org and we can get the trial version of the system. Once we enter the email address, a trial code will be sent and we can download the vulnerability scanner and we can enable. Now let's say in this particular type of system, now we can see there are a lot of features which are available on this particular scanning. So we have plugins, we have policies that are defined. Yep, one second. We can observe that there are a lot of kind of things where we can observe on the meshes. And once we go to the settings also, we can see what kind of version we are used. And as I said, this is a trial version, so there is a limitation of only 16. But in the commercial version, based on the kind of licenses we take, we can actually use this. And we also have software versions and all the other important parameters. And we can also have the individual kind of settings for password management and all the other techniques. But our main intention is for the scanning part. So for this, we need to understand the kind of policies which we already have. So for this, we already have a scan templates which are available in the Nessus. So why this scan templates means? Because whenever we want to scan a particular system, we need to understand what kind of scanning we want to actually do or we want to perform. So let's say there are some default scan templates which are available, like a simple basic network scan where it will try to scan the type of systems or the kind of vulnerabilities available in a particular network. Or we can go for the advanced scan where it will give more controls or changing in the parameters, like maybe using with respect to the passwords or logging into the systems. So some more kind of level of granularity we'll get. And also we can check for the malware scan. So this generally checks for any kind of malware that is already available on the system using this kind of template. That means generally what happens if you talk about malware scanning, so it has to use some sort of already available kind of signatures that is already there in the tool. So based on the available tool or the signatures available, the tool will try to check for the malware. And there is a new kind of feature that is coming into is called mobile device scan. So earlier it was only supporting for with respect to Windows and Linux. Now a mobile device scan is also available in the new part. And also we have a feature with respect to web application test also, where the web applications, particularly if you want to scan any kind of applications, then these applications can also be made part of. And also we have credential patch audit. And recently we have some of the attacks like the batch shell shock detection, the Spectre and Meltdown with respect to the Intel processors, and also the most notorious kind of ransomware which you have seen, the WannaCry ransomware. So these kind of templates are already available as part of this scan. So, and also the other important part which we want to highlight is the plugins. So where we can also create a new plugin. Now let's say we already know the kind of vulnerability database or the kind of CVE, then we can also use this kind of plugin ID, or we can create our own plugins to actually detect or make the customization possible. Now let's say we'll try to see a simple scan where just go to my scans here, and we need to click on the new scan. Okay, so in this we are trying to do a basic network scan. So I'm just selecting this template as part of the scanning part. So actually we also need to understand that the vulnerability analysis tools are to have some more kind of system resources, because we will be generating a lot of traffic with respect to that. So we need to enter the destination IP or the system that need to be scanned. Now let's say this is my target IP address, where 192.168.43.241. Actually, this is we can actually give the name, or we can actually mention the IP here. But let's say this is easy if we can give the name here, because we need to understand the kind of thing. So we are giving a name for the identification, and a kind of description can also be done to easily understand, and where this particular scanning has to be stored. So we are just storing it in my scans part, the default part, and here we need to mention the target. So generally the FQDN, or the, the complete SDR in it, if the DNS or the domain name or the system name is resolved, then we can directly use the domain name. or we can use the IP instead. And if there is a single or multiple targets, then we can write all the targets in a single file, and also we can attach a file there. Okay. And there are other kind of parameters which are available. So whether we want to save and scan it now or launch at this particular point of time, or we can do a scheduling part where we can enable the scheduling during, because let's say if you talk about the organization level, most of the organizations, the systems or the kind of network will be busy during the business hours. So this scanning, this may actually kind of give some delay or introduce some lagging in the network or the bandwidth also. So for these kind of things, we can also schedule the scan during the non-business hours or during a time where certain downtime can be taken. So based on this, we can also enable those scheduling part, and we can also enable for the notifications if the scan report has to be sent automatically to a particular kind of email. So instead of again logging into the system, so that kind of notifications can be done, and even the discovery. So let's say if we don't know what kind of systems that are available on the network, then we can do a simple port scan and what kind of assessments that can be done. So these kind of scanning techniques are already available within the tool. And we can also disable, let's say if you are doing the network scan, so my main focus will be on the ports and the type of operating systems. So I can disable, let's say if there is a web server available, so if we enable the web application audit, it may take some more time because it has to scan all the web application. So those kind of assessment tweakings can also be done. And what is the kind of output we want with respect to the report, that also we can actually select here. Okay. And with respect to the advanced, we can actually go for any kind of things, because as we said, during the business hours, the introduction of latency may be possible. So we can select for scan low bandwidth links or customization, where we can decide, because once a scan starts, or where we observe during the nmap scanning also, so the system will try to generate a lot of scanning kind of traffic with respect to the ports that are available. So to actually reduce this kind of traffic generated, we can go for the customization part also. And the other important part, where as part of some of the audits also, we have been observing that. So the credential-based scanning is very much important, because whenever we actually do the scanning, once we log into the system, because in this credential-based scanning, we need to also give the credentials of the system on which we are trying to scan. Okay. So once actually we use these credentials, the tool will have more control over the scanning part. I mean, there are again two different kind of things, because this is not from the attacker point of view. This is from the internal assessment point of view. Let's say we already have a tool and we want to understand the vulnerabilities that are already associated within our network. Then it is always suggestible to go for the credential-based scanning, because that will give more insight into the kind of tool, because it is already logging into the destination machine and giving us more insight into the details. And always try to disable the admin rights or the kind of things. We need to provide the admin rights sometimes with respect to the tool also, because that will also give more insight into the tool. And again, as we discussed, these are all the available plugins. So based on the kind of target, now let's say I know what is my target. So based on the kind of target, I can also select the device or the kind of vendor name where we can select the available plugins. So this will be easier where we can go for a kind of specific plugin. Now, let's say if I click on Cisco, there are available of 1717 plugins which are already available. So I can also select a specific plugin out of all the scanning, where I can also go for a specific kind of plugin scanning also is possible with respect to the vulnerability analysis. Now, once everything is done, so just make sure whether the IP everything is set or not, then we can save it, because if we enable the scheduling part, we can save it this default or the kind of template we have already done, or for immediate scanning we can directly launch the scanning. So once we launch, the tool will try to make connectivity or try to assess the destination system. Okay, so once we click on the launch, we can observe that this particular thing has been added to the My Scans part. Then we need to run the part. So we need to click on the launch, where now we can observe the tool is actually starting the launch. So we can click on this part and we can observe any kind of vulnerabilities that are being done. Oh, sorry, actually the target we have checked is 241. Okay, so it is still running and you can see the status here. Okay, the status shows it is still running. So it will take some time based on the kind of connectivity we have and based on the port scanning that is being done, because the vulnerability scanner will actually try to check each and every kind of port that is available and try to match, are there any kind of vulnerabilities that are already associated with this kind of service. So generally, most any of the vulnerability scanners, they will be making use of this thing called CVE database or the common vulnerability IDs. I mean, every vulnerability scanner has its own set of database with respect to the vulnerabilities. But to make the vulnerability generic, there is also one thing called CVE ID. Where this CVE IDs will be same across the globe. So even any one of the vulnerability scanner, if it detects, it will also mention the common CVE ID. So according to the CVE ID, again, we have what kind of possibility that is there with respect to their vulnerability, whether that vulnerability can be exploited in the remote or it is only available with respect to the local. So these kind of parameters that are that can be made with respect to that. Okay, actually this is taking some time because it requires some time, but we already have one previous vulnerability analysis which has been done on the same system. Now this is how the vulnerabilities will be looking like. Now we can see what is the severity level of that and what is the kind of information that is getting, we can actually able to see. So now let's say once we select this, so with respect to the same kind of vulnerability, there is one high vulnerability and also there is some kind of information. Information is nothing but the vulnerability cannot be exploited, but it will give some suggestions with respect to the vulnerability that is available. So now let's say there is one high vulnerability with respect to this target. Now when we click on this vulnerability, now we will actually get the clear output or the clear kind of indications what kind of threat we have with respect to this vulnerability. Now as we understood, why it is high, because this is already rated as high with respect to the SMB shared unprivileged access. That means there are some certain folders or the certain shares on this particular system which do not have any kind of authentication or so. So using this SMB kind of vulnerability, anyone can actually access. So we can see the description also here. The remote has one or more Windows shares that can be accessed through the network with a given credentials. Depending on the share rights, it may allow an attacker to read or write confidential data. So there is a possibility that the attacker can, these shares can be accessed. And we can see what is the solution also. So to restrict access under Windows, we can go to Explorer and do a right click on each share and we have to specifically go for the permission. So this is one kind of solutions that are available. Why? Because it is also saying that these kind of users, that particular folder can be read by all these kind of users. And we can see the kind of port on which this particular vulnerability is existing. That is nothing but the 445 port on this particular IP. So, and in the right hand side, we can see using this plugin. Okay, the kind of plugin which is already available in the tool, using this plugin, we have come to know that this is a vulnerability. And we can also see the kind of risk information. So this is what we are talking about, the kind of risk factor available high, and also the base score. This again, base score is depend on the kind of level of access we generally get with respect to the parameters which we already discussed in the earlier sessions, like the whether the confidentiality can be compromised or the integrity can be compromised, or whether the vulnerability can be exploited on a local resource, or it can be possible to a remote kind of thing. So based on this kind of scenario, this kind of risk information we'll get. And this is the vulnerability information where the exploit available or the kind of vulnerability publishing date can be made known to the users, right? So this is how the system can understand the kind of vulnerabilities that are available. This is one example. So similarly, we can do the same kind of scanning with using the templates that are available, like we can go for the network scan, or we can go for the operating system scans, or we can go for any kind of web applications, or we can go for any kind of templates like the malware scanning. So there are different templates available also with respect to the scanning part. And again, this is one of the tools we are discussing here, but there are other tools also which also do the vulnerability scanning. So based on the kind of functionality, but the tool output or the kind of scanning things may vary. But once we get the common CVE or the kind of vulnerabilities, we need to take the recommendations, and sometimes we also need to understand the false positives of this automatic tool also. So not that completely we need to actually take, we need to also do some manual kind of analysis also to be mixed with this kind of automatic analysis, because that anyway, that kind of things will actually, the manual analysis will complement the automatic analysis we generally do. So this is how the vulnerabilities can be known with respect to using the vulnerability analysis tool. So once we know the vulnerability, and once we know the kind of severity of the vulnerability, we can use any one of the vulnerabilities and try to check the kind of exploits that are available. Again, for this also we have both manual analysis as well as automatic and a kind of testing. So in the next demo, we'll be seeing one of the techniques of a tool called Metasploit, where we'll try to use one of the vulnerabilities that are already available on a system and try to use this tool, whether we can able to get into the system or try to hack that or try to exploit that particular system. So this is about the vulnerability analysis. So next part, we'll see a kind of demo on the kind of access or the exploitation using the Metasploit. So for this, I'm transferring the control to Mr. Gopi, where he will be demonstrating how the analysis part can be done. Please share the control to
Hello, am I audible, sir? Okay, so now we'll start doing exploiting. First, we'll start exploiting the Windows machine. by using the Metasploit, and one more tool called MSF Venom. MSF Venom is a tool which is a combination of MSF Payload and MS Encode. So by using MSF Venom, we'll create one payload and we'll deploy it on the client client machine. In client means a victim. We'll install it on client and we'll try to access the same that victim machine from our machine without even notifying the that victim. So first you use the following command to generate the payload: MSF Venom -p. So now here I am mentioning my host IP address, which is called my Kali Linux machine. To check our IP address, use command called ifconfig. So our machine IP address is 192.168.42.98. This is the IP address. Why we are mentioning is for listening that client for listening that victim. Victim communication. We need to mention our IP address. So and I am saving this output. iPhone OS for output, and I am saving this output on my desktop. And I am generating it file as chrome.exe. So if you press enter, if there is no error in that command, it will generate a payload called chrome.exe on my desktop. We'll see whether it will come or not. And that L port, local port, is 4444. I am listening on the 4444 port. So for performing an attack using Metasploit, we need to make sure that our virtual machine, which we are using in Kali Linux, should be in bridge mode. For that, we need to go to we will check in network interfaces, and this should be in bridge adapter. Okay, then only we can listen on that payload. So here I got an error called reverse TCP. That there is a spelling mistake. That reverse double R is there, so that's why the error came. So we'll try to run it again by correcting that error. So here you can see that chrome.exe file is generated. For checking whether it is generated or not, we'll use command called ls. So for checking, we need to move to that folder. So by using the change directory command, we will move to that desktop. So this system is very slow. So sometimes because of roll RAM, it is taking a bit time to load that path. So let me just check it. So here we can see that chrome.exe file has been generated on my desktop. So now what we will do, we'll by using Apache server, web server, we'll host it in a web server so that we can deploy it on a client side. So some let's say for suppose anyone want to access or anyone want to download any file from any server, what we will do, he will visit that and he will download. By the same way, we'll also do the same thing. In let's say for suppose if an attacker want to deploy that exe file on a client machine, what he will do is he may be including that payload in normal like Chrome or Firefox exe file, so that an victim will download from the other malicious websites. So he will install it and he will become the victim. So now for deploying it in a Apache web server, we need to move that chrome.exe file to /var/www.html folder. So by using the copy command, we'll move it to that folder. So I am having I am facing a system issue because the load is a bit, so we'll continue with the next session.
Hello. Can you hear me, Nandishwar? Can you acknowledge me once? Hello, are you able to hear me? Hello? Yes, ma'am. Okay, thank you. Thank you. A very good afternoon to all of you. Yeah, thank you for the acknowledgement. Very good afternoon to all of you. So we will be starting the session, the next session on web application security. And we will try to have a glimpse onto the OWASP top 10 vulnerabilities. So far, I think all the sessions were mostly discussed about our regular network-based attacks, packet capturing, analysis, how the vulnerabilities can be exploited, and so on. So this session also talks all about security, but completely towards the web application. So web application, we all host many websites, right, in our organizations. So when we host so many things, so still we come across a lot of news saying so-and-so website is being hacked out. Some websites, there is a data leakage happening. All of this news comes up. So the major reason most of the times in all of these kind of hacks is some of the other vulnerabilities exist, which gets exploited at some point, and then the attacks happen. So in this session, we will try to understand on how the attackers try to reach us, what causes the vulnerabilities to be existing on the system, and what kind of attacks or what kind of vulnerabilities lead to what kind of attacks is what we will try to understand. So myself, I'm Indra Veni from CDAC Hyderabad. So I will be continuing on this particular session. So as I said briefly, the agenda of our training of this session is something like this. We will understand some basic concepts. This is not going to be technical. It's very, very generic in, if you all have seen websites, so from a website perspective only, I will try to explain you what all things can be there. So there are certain technical aspects we'll try to see in whatever way we can understand easily by all of us. So after understanding about the basic on websites and all, how the information leaks out, how the people gather information, and then we try to go towards the OWASP top 10. This would be our basic agenda. So in case any questions are there to participants, you are free to ask immediately through in the chat box, because I understand that there is a time constraint that we need to end the sessions by 5:30, so we may not have time for a detailed question answer session at the ending. And so in case some questions are arise, you may please feel free to put up in the chat box. I will try to answer them as soon as I see it. So I won't be, as you all are already into the net systems for so many years, I'll not be putting brief on to background slot. So this slide just talks about the web, where basically web is nothing but internet users are there. Through internet, we access so many things over the web. And the browser is the key client for accessing the World Wide Web, right? However, from protecting various attacks from the web or the World Wide Web or from internet, mostly in home, at home, we all use our operating system firewall. Windows, if it is Windows, we turn on Windows firewall. We ensure our Wi-Fi passwords are strong enough. We ensure we have antivirus and all of these things. However, coming to the institutes, to protect against the attacks coming through internet on the organizations, we use a secured environment, or we configure a secured environment using firewalls, IDS, intrusion detection systems, intrusion prevention systems, all of these things, right? So when we put all of these things together, a secured environment we build for our servers, that environment is called as the DMZ, demilitarized zone. So a zone where nobody can enter without a proper authentication, or it can be without a proper channel or without a genuine identity. So all of these security protocols are being placed, which is called as the DMZ. And so organizations try to protect their servers by using all of these security mechanisms. So when all of these things are placed, so like as you're seeing in the right side, this picture, this talks about the servers, and the orange circle around these is nothing but the DMZ. So there are so many organizations where they host their servers, and all of them are well protected on the DMZ environment. And towards the left, all of these are clients, nothing but it can be a browser from a systems, from a laptop or anything. They try to access the website that is hosted on this server, which are protected in the DMZ environment. So the first point that comes in over here is, when this kind of communication is happening from a client to the server, what is visible over the internet? We consider that when somebody is accessing, as a layman, we feel that the website is running, I am seeing the web page. However, on the internet, there is so much of data that is flowing across, and there are people who keep watching on that data, which is very important for them to plan the future attacks. That's called as information leakage happening on the internet, basically. So, for a layman, when I access from the client a particular website, there is a hit going to the server and the data is coming in. However, when the request is going, I mean from the client, when there is a request going to server, it is generally a request and the server responds back, means it is a response. So during this communication, there is a lot of data that is going. So let us understand the first phase of understanding what attackers will see on our servers, which you also, in case you are in the domain of security team, or you are managing some websites or anything, this topic can be interesting to you, because through this topic you will understand, you yourself can identify how much of information is getting leaked from your server to the public domain, that is to the internet world, which can be seen by anyone who is accessing the website. So before I move towards that, generally what the developer or any system administrator think of is, my website is always secure. Thumb rule number one is, my website is always running on port number 80, and so my website is secure. In fact, I have seen many a times people saying that when you're running a website on port other than 80, it is not secure. Does that mean that if I'm running on port 80, it is secure? So most developers think that this is one of the thumb rule for them, that it is secure. Second thing is, if there is a HTTPS and there is a lot of website is hosted on HTTPS, it is considered to be secure. And third might is, everything is being blocked using my firewall. So my organization is maintaining a DMZ environment. So there is a firewall, there is an IDS, there is an IPS, and so my website is secure. This is what any developer or administrator usually think of. However, though this is the scenario, there are a lot many things that are possible only through these things available also. As you can see from this picture, the red block what you see over here is the firewall. The red block what you see is the firewall. And you can see that there are different types of attacks. So the left side blocks, so the topmost box is listed with the attacks related to the one which are possible on port 80. And the bottom, the brown colored box has a list of attacks which are possible on any system. It can be on an operating system or something like a brute force, a buffer overflow, RPC, null session kind of thing. So usually these are all performed on different ports. Now, when I'm targeting a website to perform any attack, usually that is possible, those attacks are, I have to perform on port 80. And so, for an organization to host a website, it definitely need to open up port 80 or whichever port the website is running onto, so that it gets served on the internet. So now for the attacker, this is the only path to enter into your environment. So though you have a firewall, we ourselves keep the port 80 open at the firewall so that our website is accessible to public. And the same way, the same gate is used by attackers also to perform various web-based attacks on the application. And that can be at the application level. As you can see the green box here, right side, the attacks are usually performed on the application level, which in turn affects the services that are running on the system, that in turn affects the operating system also. As well, from the application level, even they can perform attacks on the database. So it's not that the attacks are limited only to the application which is running. I can, from these attacks, I can create a system operating systems administrative user. I can create n number of users on the OS level. I can delete the data from the database. So from the application itself, there is a reach to all of these things because all of them are connected on our server. So it is very, very important at this stage for us to understand how these attacks are performed and now what I need to take care as a developer, what I have to take care as an website hosting administrator, how I have to protect my organization. All of these things we will try to understand as an overview. So from this, we are trying to conclude that simple web-based attacks, reachability is not only to the application, but it reaches your services, your operating system to the database as well. So with this technical information, let us just see, like I was just saying earlier sometime back, that there is a request going from a client to the server. Server processes that request. So sometimes it just reads the data, reads the page and shows to users. Sometimes it processes with the database and gives the response back. So when this request and response is happening, this is how the website usually works. What is flowing in between them? Usually when request goes, when the response comes back, there's a lot of data that flows over here. So this is called as a HTTP headers. The HTTP headers flow from request to from client to server, and server to client also response comes in. This data has lot of information. So this is an a view of how the request response is visible usually. This is a breakup of request line. And so initially when a request goes, it will have first line to be a request line, followed by headers, followed by a blank line and a body. And the response line also would have the same thing. And this is the breakup. So maybe we will come to this thing after understanding a little bit much better. So now let me, before I go further, I'll just show you in the browser itself how this request and response, now I was mentioning, right, this slide. When any user accesses any website from the browser, all of this information flows to the server, which talks about my browser version, from where I have accessed this website, what my browser accepts, which all types of data, HTML, XML and all, what is my language that I'm using on my laptops or computers. All of this information, which is nothing but information about the client. Client is the person who is initiating the request, right? So all of this information is there as part of the request. And when this information goes to the server, server gives a response. So as part of that, the server response header comes in, where all of this information is there. So server says 200, okay, yes, I am having the page that you are asking for. Immediately, the server also adds some more headers talking about the date, what is the timestamp of the server, which web server I am using, what is the expiry date of a particular page, all of this information. So the screen where I was showing when request is going and response is coming, there are many eyes that are watching on this communication. Basically, those eyes can see this data. The request, what going, and the response, what's coming out. This data is visible to the attackers. So this is the first place where most of the information is leaked about the web servers, and people will understand what that information is talking about. Yeah, so there's one question from one of the user, Mr. Vijay Kota. Sometimes my Safari browser opens up unknown tabs. Why it happens and what is the possible remedy available? So basically, sir, this is mostly, I mean, the behavior of browser opening unknown tabs automatically is a symptom for having some malware or a malicious script running on the system, or it could be a browser's extension which is trying to do something. Maybe you can explore to Safari browser's extensions and other things. So we can, however, this is, I can detailedly discuss on this later to the session also. Right, sir? So request and response headers is how it is happening. So I'm just opening up my browser over here to show you. For example, I'm just opening one of my website, infosecawareness.in itself I would open. Now generally, I was mentioning when you open a browser, okay, and when it type when we type a particular website, what happens? In fraction of seconds, the browser rotates and it shows the page to us, right? So in this fraction of seconds, what happens? I was mentioning in my presentation that there is a request going and the response coming. How does the attacker see that? So it's very easy. They are all available as part of the browser plugins also. So you can use the function key F12 in your browser, which opens up a window like this in your browser. So this is called as a web debugger plugin. This is nowadays it is available by default with all the browsers. It's Chrome is available. Chrome is having, Firefox is having. So when you open up this tab, generally when you open it, may be having you a page like this. You will have to go to the tab called network over here. Okay. So when you access this network tab and try to access the web page again, once again. So when you see, when the browser is trying to process the page, it took some time and then it has shown me some content over here. So when I click on any of those links that has come here, in the right side, I get some more pages. So the headers tab is something that we are interested in. So this plugin helps us to see what happened when I typed in a URL in the browser over here. I'm just trying to drag this a little up. So as I'm saying, my browser is my client. In client, I have typed infosecawareness.in. Immediately what happens, the very first moment, the domain name resolution happens through the respective DNS server. After that, the communication goes to the respective server, physical server through the IP. So when the request is going, the below you can see here the request header, right? This request header is what I was trying to show you in my slide also. So request header, as you see, the first line, get slash HTTP 1.1. It means my browser is asking to fetch slash. Slash is the home directory, the first page. In, followed by this, there is no other domain, right? No other name. So it is the first page and using HTTP 1.1 protocol of which website? Of this particular website, host infosecawareness.in. So when I type in infosecawareness.in in the browser formulates this kind of a request and it sends to the server. So this this request has information like the get. It has information of which host it is trying to fetch and what is the user agent. I'm using Firefox user, Firefox browser. This information is available with my version and all of this data. Say, for example, I use the same website in a different way. For example, I go to google.com first. And from google.com, I try to access infosecawareness.in. And from here, I'm fetching this page. Again, I press F12. Then you see what happens over here is, from google.com, I tried to search InfoSec awareness and then came to this particular page. At this moment, if you see, I'm showing the raw header to you. See, again, the same get slash HTTP 1.1, host InfoSec awareness, my user agent, and so on. And then in the bottom, you can see referrer google.com. So this tells that a user have tried to access this particular website by searching it in google.com. So from where this website has been referred is what has been replicated through this referrer header. Like this, a user's behavior, a user's request related information is sent from the client to the server, and there is this all this information flows from client to server. Okay, this gives an understanding for server to actually plan on which language it has to show. Server have to plan about what. I mean, it can actually create its statistics, how many people have done a Google search, how many people have directly accessed my website. All of these informations, analysis and all can be done using this information at the server level. Now coming to the interesting part, there is a response header, which is actually given by the server. Now this is a response header. Now when this request is going to the server, server takes that, it understands that, okay, there is a request coming. Immediately it looks for whether slash is there in InfoSec awareness page. It is there, so immediately it'll try to respond back HTTP 200 okay. And then it also gives information about which server version it is using, and there are other headers which talks about its security or other aspects. So if you see in other any other websites, most of the times there is a lot of information gets leaked out saying what version of web server they are using, what all plugins they are having, what methods they have. So much of information gets revealed as part of the server header. And this is what is the most crucial thing for many of the users. Sometimes even we see that a specific version of ASP.NET is used, a specific version of PHP is used. Like this, lot of information gets saved. Like this is one of my test portal. Here, let me show you what response, what server data is being visible over here. So it shows that this is a cookie value. These are the connection strings and so on. And for the same website on port 80. So here also it gives you some information. See here you can see a little bit interesting part. This website is using Apache 2.4.25 version. It is hosted on a Debian operating system and it has some plugins being enabled. So what I'm trying to, all I'm trying to tell you is when a user is accessing any website, usually on the browser, directly we see a page, but there is a lot of content that goes from client to server and server also gives back a lot of content as part of its headers. So this content can be misused by the attackers to plan their attack. Now, as soon as I know that this version of web server is being used, immediately as an attacker, I will try to look for in the internet for various vulnerabilities which are associated with 2.4.25 version of Apache. And then I can start running those exploits. Few minutes back, we have seen a demonstration using of Mesos and Metasploit by Gopinath, where they have shown you how the inbuilt exploits can be executed and how Mesos identifies the vulnerability. So they all usually see the version leakage over here. And from here, they try to find identify what all CVE vulnerabilities are there with this particular version. And then they try to exploit upon. So this is how one can know or identify information that has been leaked out from the server. This is some part of the information from the header. So moving towards the presentation. So what I was referring to was related to this only. The what I have shown you just now, the request response and all is the breakup of this content. The first line was the request line where we are saying get slash HTTP 1.1, right? That was the request line. Followed by so many headers where you saw what is our user agent, what is our referrer tag, all of these things. Then there would be a blank line and then actual body. Sometimes our data, for example, if we log in, our credentials will be there as part of the body. All of this data will be there in the request header. Similarly, when the request goes to server, server responds back. And when the request is going and server responds back, generally server response is also broken up into three parts: HTTP version, status code, and the status phrase. And HTTP version is nothing but HTTP 1.1, like as we have seen just now over here. This is nothing but the response line. So over here, this is the HTTP version, this is the status code, and this is the status phrase. So HTTP 1.1 is the version, 200 is the status code. 200 is, you see here the codes, the status codes are usually either 100 series, either 200, 300, 400, or 500. These are the five series of status codes that you can usually see on your server. So whenever there is a 200 series, 2XX, it can be 200, 201, 202, depending on different behavior of the server. Whenever there is a 200 series status code, it means that the request is successfully processed by the server. Whereas if there is a server status code with a sequence of 300 or 400 or something, each of them have different meanings. So 100 is usually informational. It gives the server tries to give some information to the client. Whenever there is a 300 error code, it means that there is a redirection happening. It means from client I have tried to ask a particular page. Server is not having that page, but server knows where it is there. So server tries to redirect me to that particular page. In such scenarios, 300 series error codes will be visible. So these error codes again are again most important for the attacker. They try to understand the server's behavior and try to give you page, try to misuse the information. Let's say, for example, I come back over here. This is the test portal, right? So let me just try to fetch a page which is not there, DSFD something. So as you can see here, this is the page which I am trying to fetch, which is not there on the server. Immediately you see the status code should be 400, right? 404 file not found. And with this, the user is also getting some information on the browser itself about the version, about the servers and so on. Similarly, if there is a 500 series error, no, it could, you will sometimes see application level, programming level errors also. We will see some demonstration of it later. So At an initial level, it is important for us to understand that the status codes are there, and from these status codes also information gets leaked out to an extent. So this is a brief about the initial information that leaks out from these servers, request, response, and so on. So before we move further for the next topic, I just wanted to have a small quiz question. Can somebody answer? You can put your answers in your chat box. Maybe you can put it to all participants, all to host also. Anything is okay for us. So how a third person or third party can see this information? See, third party or third person, for example, for them also, the application is accessible on the browser, right? So for anybody, once the website is open to public, it is available to everybody. And so on their browser itself, they can open up the website and see the information like this. So I'm trying to show you the information as a third party itself. If you give me your organization website, even for that website, we can see over here because it is available in internet. So anybody for the available in internet using the browser's available plugins, I'm just trying to show this. We are not using any tools over here. Okay, sir. So I'm just coming back to my question. Sensitive information about a server or website can be visible in which? Is it in request header, response header, or we will see sensitive information in error codes like 300 series or 400 series responses, or all of the above? Okay, I'll give a 1 minute time. Maybe people can put up your answers over here. I got 3 responses, few more. Yeah, good. Answer is yes, it is B, the response header. All of the above will be true in case our question would be sensitive information can be visible in what? If I say only sensitive information visible, it can be all. But here we are mentioning the question is sensitive information about a server or a website. So about the server, it is mentioned it is available only in the response. About the client is part of the request. And so the answer is B, the response header. Thank you. Many of you have answered response header. Good. So moving towards our further topic. So the whatever information we have just now seen on our browser on this particular thing, the same thing can be. One is this, this is the HTTP traffic, right? Viewing and analyzing HTTP traffic. We can view this data in 3 ways. One is using the browser debugger, which we have done just now, using F12 key on your browser. Preferably go with the Firefox because Firefox has a defaultly this debugger enabled. In Chrome, we have the debugger, but we need to enable certain more plugins to see in detail actually. So go with the Firefox, it has this much of detailed information. This is what we have already seen just now. Apart from this, we can also use a web proxy to see this information. Usually a web proxy is used by security testing teams or hackers or anybody who would like to, and even sometimes developers also use proxy to understand certain things on whether the application is trying to send any sensitive information in plain text, whether applications is tamperable or not. All these kinds of things one can do on this proxies. So I would just demonstrate to you on the same thing. Next, we will use the Burp Suite proxy tool. You can also use OWASP Zap proxy. There are so many proxy tools. Burp Suite is one free tool available. Community edition is available, which anybody can use. So I'm just initiating the Burp Suite proxy. So it is available for Windows as well as Linux. You can just download and start using it. Now, in this, what we will do is we will just try to open up a proxy over here one, two, three, third tab, proxy tab, and have your proxy set enabled. So this means the proxy is running on 127.0.0.1 on port 8080. So the moment I set this tool and I am here on the proxy, I just have to go to my browser, and in my browser I go to my settings where we usually do our configurations, network settings. You just have to go to your network settings in browser. Here you have to set manual proxy configuration and set your IP 127.0.0.1 and 8080. This means that the moment I set over here like this, any website I access on this browser, it goes via this proxy. Whatever IP I give, it goes via this. Most of the organizations have a proxy server. So in your offices, you may be using a different proxy server. It means that your website or your accesses on the browser is being sent via this proxy server. So I have set this proxy server and I'm saying okay, and then close this. Now on this burp suit, I'm just dividing my screen. I'm keeping half of the screen in burp suit, and my other half I'm keeping the browser. So for your convenience, I hope you can understand. Okay, so the left part I have kept my browser over here, and the right side I have kept my burp suit proxy. And you have your one tab called as intercept over here. So intercept off, intercept on. When interception is on, at that time you can see every request coming here over here. Okay, so I have turned on the interception now, and I say enter in this website. So you can see here, earlier we were seeing the same data on our browser's plugin by pressing F12 key. Now the same information I am seeing here on the proxy over here. So my request I have typed. If you notice here in the browser, the processing circle on the top is still rotating, because the request that is initiated by the browser have not reached the server yet. My proxy has cached it. It has kept it hold here. In proxy, I'm trying to see whether this data is, you can see here the data host gets slash host, all of this data is going. The moment I say here forward, then only this request goes to the server. Now you see the server is loading. There are some more requests. This is related to Google, Ledger, other websites. So each request comes here. The moment I keep forwarding each of these requests, then only my website gets loaded over here. If you have to see, I'll demonstrate this once again, especially by opening in a new, See, I've just typed in the website again. And I would also enable responses to be seen over here. Okay. So get slash request has gone. Now you see in the left side browser, there is website web page did not get loaded. I click it forward. Some more requests are going. This is the 200 OK response that has come. And this is the HTML body of the page that will been sent by server. See, now also you should understand here, this response, the proxy has cached it. This did not reach from proxy to the browser. That is why in browser, the still page is not loading. The moment I click forward, only then this response goes to the browser. See, the response went back. Another request have gone to server. Further, I am submitting forward, forward. So each request gets submitted. I can keep watching all the requests and responses that are being sent by this website to the server. For each and for each and every CSS file, for each and every image, this kind of request goes there. See, still my page is loading. If you see here, my page is still partially loaded. Still some images have not yet come because those images are getting fetched over here. I'm clicking forward still. So this is how each request you can actually see, try to intercept and change. Now when I'm able to see over here, I can even change that and send to the server. That is called as interception, chamfering. So when someone wants to perform malicious activity, they try to access this and they try to do some interception over here. So let me show you one simple example of logging in itself. I have a test application loaded over here. I'm just forwarding. Okay, I turned off interception. So this is one test application. I'm just coming to the customer login page. Now I turn on my interception and I try to log in as login. So the first page you see here, I've tried to login. It is trying to login, and my username password are visible over here. And then I send the request. Server responds back. And here I'm able to see the login. So the same behavior, what I can do, I've dropped out. I will login as admin. Meet again, Andy. I say login. And here I do a tampering. And password. So the actual credential I have entered over here is Asmith user. But in between, I'm tampering the request and changing the username password to something else. And see, I'm able to log in as administrator. So in the proxy, whatever we tamper, the tampered content can go to the server successfully, and server's response come back based on the tampering. Now, this is just a simple example I wanted to show to understand, for your understanding, and how one can intercept the communication and do a tampering on the data. Now, this same logic people try to use to perform various attacks, like SQL injection and so on, many things. So I'm just turning it off now. So this burp suit proxy can be used to actually see the request responses as well as to tamper the data and so on. And the third way is network capturing. I think sometime back you were also seeing Wireshark packet capturing, maybe yesterday or today. So the same communications you can also see in your Wireshark network packet capturing, and this is how the data would be visible. Only one thing I would like to add over here is, if the website is using HTTPS, in that case, in Wireshark, you would not be able to see this kind of a packet over here. In plain, you can't see all of this data. If it is HTTPS, all of this would be encrypted. However, if it is HTTPS, even then, in this proxy, the content can be seen in plain text. Because the difference is, the WebSuite proxy is running at the application level, whereas the Wireshark is running at the network layer. Among the OSI layers, if you all can remember, the network layer is something where the packet flows beyond the application layer and goes to the network layer. So that's where the HTTPS encryption actually works. And so in the Wireshark packet, you can see all of this data in plain. If it is HTTPS, you can't see it. However, in WebSuite proxies, you can see it in plain text until and unless application itself does some kind of encryption apart from HTTPS. So that's the difference between the proxy and the Wireshark. But for an initial understanding, how the request and responses can be viewed on among the three, these are the three mechanisms in which we can see the request and responses: the debuggers, the proxy, and the network packet capturing. So I think there's one question from one of the participants. Is banking website IDs and passwords are 128-bit? Yeah, so that was a good question. That is what I was trying to explain you. I'll show you the demonstration of the banking itself so that you can be sure on that. Let me take SBI itself, because I know how SBI is working. So SBI online, I just turned off. Okay. So I'm trying to use SBI banking. Now, since this is HTTPS, any other website? Can anyone, in any other website which is using HTTPS but and it has logins? Let me try our own portal. Yeah, makes it check is there. I'll give you two scenarios. In this case also we have HTTPS, and in State Bank of India also we have HTTPS, right? Now, let me first go to this portal where HTTPS is there, and I'm trying to sign in over here with one of the credential, which I'm considering that to be fail-loading. I'm just trying to test, so I'll just say indravinikatkira.in. Password is password D749L. So my intention over here is to just show you how the proxy will see the credentials. It's correct or not is not my job as of now. So I entered username password, and I have turned on the interception on the proxy. And now I'm clicking on sign in. See, as soon as you see here, this entire data, you can see, apart from capture, all of the other data is encrypted. This is one way of encrypting the data at the application level. The same thing would happen in for some of the applications, although HTTPS is there. There are some applications which do not perform this application level encryption. Now, I'm just dropping this packet since I don't want to continue. Same is the case with the SBI. In SBI also, I'll try to test. And then I see. Now, you may notice one point over here. When I click login, though my password is of some 6-8 characters over here, I've entered a wrong password here. Though I've entered the 8 characters, the moment I click on login, this 8 characters changes to increases, and then the response you can see over here in the proxy. I clicked on login. See, it has increased, right? It means that at the browser level, there is some kind of encryption or hashing, solid hashing technique is being used so that my password is not in plain over there. As soon as it comes to proxy, yep, see, this is the proxy. And whatever credential I've entered just now, you can see my username is as it is available over here, what I entered. However, my password seems to be in an encrypted fashion. Right? So, this is the good practice for the banking website or sensitive information. Even though HTTPS is there, still it is recommended to go for a application level encryption of credentials so that if someone downgrades HTTPS, there are attacks on HTTPS also. If someone perform attack on HTTPS, credentials don't get compromised. So this is the way how banks are supposed to work, and most banks are already doing them. So sir, did this answer your question? However, there are cases where even HTTPS is there also, we can see the credentials should be there in plain text, in the web proxy, because they don't do application level. Any keylogger can still know our password? Yes, sir. Keylogger, obviously, they can know because, see, in all of this scenario, we are talking at the application level. But the keylogger is something which is trying to monitor our keyboard. And that is the reason to avoid keyloggers only, these online banking and all, they have started coming up with this on-screen keyboards. So in case you are trying to use the on-screen keyboard, then keyloggers may not identify what is your password. However, there are intelligent keyloggers also available who can do a screen reading. That is the reason nowadays even for the on-screen keyboards, where is the on-screen keyboard? Yeah, enable virtual keyboard. So there is one security practice that people have to follow when going with on-screen keyboards like this, virtual keyboard. The point is, this virtual keyboard should not show the characters on the same pattern every time. Like say now I have accessed it. You can see X is in the bottom here, the E is here, S is here, right? Now if I refresh this page and access the virtual keyboard once again, it has to show me a different pattern. See, you don't see X in the bottom here. The pattern changed. This is one of the best practices people have to use for virtual keyboards. Randomization in this generation of this layout also. Because on-screen keyboards are trying to read these patterns and save them, and further later on, based on the screen movements, your mouse movements, people are trying to even hack on the passwords. So there are keyloggers which can read keys, strokes, keyloggers which can read on-screen also. So if before we use as a user for us, we have to ensure that, okay, this virtual keyboard is regularly changing, so I can safely use this virtual keyboard. That's how the user have to interpret. And if we are the developer, we need to take care that these kind of things happen on the application. Yeah, okay, great. Thank you, sir. Also, this is clear. Okay, now, with this explanation of some basics on these proxies and all, I've just put out some points. These points I'm not going to explain in this session. These are only for the pointers for somebody who is interested in learning about the security aspects of web applications and all. You will have to, if you really want to explore more on these concepts and perform testing on a website, these points you have to understand. You should understand what are the methods, how one can exploit applications using methods, and what are the custom headers, how one can create custom headers and attack, what are the cookies, modules related to web servers, and various other things, how you are accessing servers to upload the content on. So some technical things which we need to know before we actually perform the attack. So now with this information, misuse of revealed information, web servers or programming language software without latest patches, updates and all, usually information you buy all of this, like I was, this is nothing but I was telling about the version review, right? Version 2.4.25 patch is known. Immediately hackers will try to identify loopholes of that particular version. So now, okay, all of this information is there. But let us understand how attackers reach us. It's not only technical, you know, attackers reach us in different ways. The first and foremost thing is they decide upon the target. They wanted to attack the education system. They wanted to attack defense. They wanted to attack ministry. Which ministry? Like this, they try to target somebody. Or the other way around, they try to target based on the technology. For example, there is some news came out saying that so-and-so or Cisco router is having this vulnerability, remote code execution vulnerability. Immediately, attackers try to look around in the internet world, who is using Cisco router? Who has opened up the Cisco router vulnerable to remote code execution? Either they go with the organization name or they go with the technology. So in that way, they try to decide upon the target. After they decide that, they try to gather information about the target. 90% of the attacker's time, they usually spend on information gathering. The remaining 10% only is required to perform the attack, because information gathering is the biggest asset for any attacker, where it helps them to craft the most easiest exploit on the target application. Then they pick up the lucky day. Lucky day is nothing but, for attackers, lucky day would be the day when his attack is becoming more popular. And that day is nothing but for an organization, say for example, an organization is announcing a big conference. And fortunately, that is a security conference. So for hackers and activist people are very interested in doing such activities. They immediately see the news and think, okay, this organization is doing a security conference. Let me break their conference portal. And they know all the issues. They do a lot of information gathering. They find out the weaknesses about the conference portal and all. But they don't perform attack on the day one. They wait for the day when the conference gets launched. On that day, they perform the attack. So it means that whenever we see an attack is happening on a website, we need to investigate for the past 1 year what kind of behavior is being done on the web, on our servers. Then only we can one can track the incident, how the attacker is able to crack into the system and so on. And finally, on that particular day, they perform the exploit. Now, as I was saying, for deciding upon the target, they pick up a lot of means, news articles, they look on the internet newspaper and all to know about various events conducted by the organizations. Sometimes, you know, even we see news like an organization says that we are very strong in security, we are storing our data very secured enough, our customer data is strong enough. Immediately, in a week or two, we see an attack performing on that kind of thing. It may be major, may not be major also, but the attackers keep watching people on the papers, on the public domains, on social networking and all, whoever talks about themselves to be insecure, they try to target them. So it's very important for us, in case we are trying to be on a social network media a lot, we need to be secured first ourselves, we need to make secure, and then we need to go further. Then attackers interested our target audience, either they, as I said, they speak up organization, institute or something. Then they also do a lot of information gathering on the search engines, job postings and all. For example, I'll just talk about job posting as of now because of time. Say an organization is giving a job advertisement of 10 years system administrator immediate joining. This is the job advertisement. When someone sees this advertisement, what does it give us information? Obviously, that organization is trying to have an experienced network administrator and they want it immediately. So it could be that the current system administrator is not available or he may be leaving in short time. These two might be the reasons. Or their bandwidth, existing bandwidth is not sufficient to handle their network security. So they are looking for a new person to join immediately. So from these conclusions, for the attacker, he thinks that, okay, this must be the right time for me to perform an attack on the organization or to send various packets to gather a lot of information, because their network administrator may be overloaded or he is not available to monitor me and stop me. That's how people try to look for. Any time, most of the times, whenever there is immediate requirements or higher level posts are coming up, definitely people try to look for and target those the activities related to them and perform attacks related to that. So similarly, paste bin searches and all, there are a lot of information available. Say if I want to attack defense organization, DRDO, DRDS, they immediately go to paste bin and try to look for DRDO related any information is there or not. You may be wondering why DRDO information will be there in paste bin. It would be there because, see, there are two, three types of hackers. Some hackers usually gather information and they put it in paste bin. Some hackers sell it for money in the black dark web and all. So few people do it just for their enthusiasm, and so they keep it in paste bin. So paste bins are one place where people get lot of information, like credit card information and all. And yes, I should not forget this. And this is one of the reasons for why the passwords are requested to be changed frequently, because most of the times all of these websites, when being compromised, usually they try to put all the credentials in these paste bins kind of a thing. Say for example, in paste bin I want to see credit card information. The credit card numbers Google itself is giving me, paste bin credit card numbers. See, someone have already got this information and they try to put it. So if any hacker is interested to do some misuse, they will try to use this. Fortunately, if this is correct, he gets in. If it is not correct, he don't get any money. Just a trial and attempt kind of thing. So similarly, even the Gmail credentials, Gmail accounts, if you see, leaked email accounts in Facebook, we get a combination of username, passwords, email address, passwords and all available in the Facebook. I guess this is wrong. Yeah. Email, password. Email, password. So we do not know whether our passwords are being compromised earlier or not. That is the reason the banks, emails, everybody keep on saying, keep changing your password once in a month, because once in 3 months. Because for example, if it has been hacked out, it is somewhere out there in the paste bin or public forum, which can be misused by anybody. It may be old or data also. That's why people even suggest don't use old password every time. Every time we have to set for a new password. So these are some locations from where people can actually fetch data and gather information. And search engines like Google and all also give a lot of information. Like I can just type in like this in URL, admin login in, title Apache Tomcat, and I can just get information onto which all websites are having this vulnerability. As I was saying, Cisco router, right? And similarly, for example, in title, I say in Apache Tomcat examples. Basically, Apache Tomcat examples is one of the vulnerability related to one of the vulnerability through which one can exploit some internal system level thing. Now, see, in Google, I have just typed in title Apache Tomcat examples. So Google is trying to search in the World Wide Web all the websites. And whichever website is having a Tomcat examples kind of a title in their page, that is being shown. Now, say for example, this is one thing which could be interesting for us. Apache Tomcat examples title is there. And this is some CVE21.com website. And when I access it, it's taking time, maybe it's there or it might be not there. So in this space, Google search engine itself, okay, I have a box suit here. Let's turn it off. Why it is not showing is sometimes certain SSL based things don't work directly. So we will have to do some configuration for that. That's the reason, due to proxy, the site was not loading. Let me try now. So these are called as Google Docs basically. These phrases, no, in title, in URL, admin login, in title, Apache Tomcat. These are all called phrases with Google Docs. So by this also people try to search and target the organizations, admin login. See, these are all pages. I just typed in URL, admin login. It will try to search in the World Wide Web which all websites is having admin login pages it will give you. Now, if one is trying to learn injection or something, he will try to look into all of these pages and try to target some attacks on it. So that's how the interception and activities can happen. So I think we are almost to the end, 5:30. Actually, the session was planned much. Some more information is there. However, we'll try to end this because you have a time. We have a time constraint here. So let me put one last question for this day. Metaica spend most of the time in understanding organization, A. B, exploring open ports on a website. C, gathering hosted info environment details. D, all of the above. What is the answer? Great, two questions. Any more attempts, please? Yeah, very good. Yes, it is D. All of these, they spend all of this information, understanding organization, exploring open ports, gathering hosted environment details. So all of them are part of the information gathering only. So they spend most of the time on this. And then they perform the actual attack on the target applications. So yeah, this is the answer, all of them. So fine, I think we will end the session now. And in case time permits, we may continue it later. If not, we will give you an recorded session or something. We will try to provision it. So in case any questions so far, quickly we can have. Else, I think Nandishwar, if you are there, you may try to conclude or say something if you would like to. Else, I can end up. Any questions, anyone? Okay, I guess no questions. Nandishwar, would you like to say something or shall I end up? Okay, then I think there are no more questions from the members. We will end the session for today, and the remaining presentations we'll try to give you on the e-learning platform, which you can access it later on. And if time permits, I would take another session to cover the rest of the topic that is OWASP top 10. Thank you all. I hope you are able to understand what I was trying to explain through this particular session. Thank you. Have a good evening. Thank you. Thank you.